Today, I'm going to talk about a credible alternative to Creative Suite. Adobe's Creative Suite, to be exact. But here's the thing. I'm not going to give you a bunch of free open source examples that'll have you tearing your hair out. Because as a serious creative, that's not what you need. What you need is a straight up, genuine alternative that fulfills your creative needs. But more than that, it has to have an overall benefit to you. Hey, welcome back. And if it's your first time here, just welcome. Today, I'm going to introduce you to an Adobe alternative that works. So what annoys you about Adobe? The price, right? The software works.
Works well.
But it's that damn subscription. It's killing you. Well, Affinity Suite is just as good, if not better in some instances, and is available for an affordable one-time fee. That's right. One time. You pay and you play forever. And that's how software used to get sold. And get this, it's not a US-based company. It's British, which might mean something to you at this moment in time. Just saying. Now, I'm not going to go into huge details. There's lots of content online already, and this is just an introduction to the whole suite. Now, Affinity is not paying me to do this video. They don't even know I'm making it. I bought into the ecosystem a few years ago, and I really liked it, and I think you will too. And recently, I started to use the whole suite. However, before we dive in, let's have a quick history lesson, because I'm old enough to remember a time before Adobe. That's right. Before Adobe, before mobile phones, before the internet, it was a land of milk and honey. It actually wasn't, but it's not that sort of history lesson. After graphic designers put down their pencils and they put down their scalpels, they picked up Quark Express. And for years, at the start of my design career, Quark Express was king. Top of the pile, no contenders. And graphic designers would use Quark Express for print markup. And for pictures, they used a program from a small software company called Adobe. And that was Photoshop. Now, every publishing house and creative studio in the world used Quark and Photoshop. But Adobe was working away in the background, developing, buying, scheming, if you will. And in 1999, Adobe introduced InDesign. Graphic designers everywhere ignored it. Quark Express was what they used, and that's all they were going to use. They were never going to use InDesign. But Adobe bundled the software with Photoshop, creating the beginnings of Creative Suite, and they made it cheap. Finance departments were perhaps the drivers of the switch to Adobe's Creative Suite, because you could buy a Creative Suite license for just a little bit more than a Photoshop license, which meant you were basically getting InDesign for free. And Quark was expensive. The bean counters loved it. They loved it so much that within a few years, the indestructible Quark Express sunk into obscurity. And Adobe seems to have forgotten that. So focused have they been on making money out of us creatives that they've forgotten what they did to Quark Express. That subscription model introduced in 2011 is okay for professional design studios, but it's crippling small creatives and keen amateurs. And I bet a few finance controllers are not best pleased either. And that's why a few years ago, I searched out an alternative and found one in Affinity. And Affinity Suite offers Affinity Photo, Affinity Designer, and Affinity Publisher. Three cornerstone pieces of software for creatives. They allow you to process images, create and modify vector graphics, and design and lay out print-ready artwork. In short, they do everything a creative studio needs. As a photographer, a graphic designer, and a brand consultant, I now use all three. So let's take a look and stick around until the end when I show you why it's now worth ditching Adobe for Affinity. First up is perhaps the most popular of the three, Affinity Photo. Now, one of the biggest headaches for creatives is learning new software. Well, you don't really have to with Affinity Photo because it operates just like Photoshop. Looks a bit like it too. It's got the familiar tools, familiar menus, and even familiar workflow. Say I want to work on a RAW file, and Affinity works with all the RAW formats as you'd expect. Let's take this one, and it's from my Nikon Z9. Opening it brings the image up in the develop persona. Affinity uses what it calls personas. Develop is akin to Adobe's Camera Raw. You have the ability to work on exposure, color temperature, color balance, highlights, distortion, noise reduction, you know, the sort of thing. Everything and anything that needs a tweak to produce a decent looking image can be done in here. Once developed, the image is ready to be worked on. As I said, I'm not going to give a full rundown as it will take an age, but you have the ability to do just about anything that you need to, from cutouts to sharpening. You can take an image from this to this without even breaking a sweat. One of the potential downsides is batch processing. It is possible, but you have to use macros, a process you create. This is how Photoshop did batch processing before Lightroom came along. And it's easy enough, but it can be seen as a downside. I mean, personally, I don't batch process lots of similar pictures because I'm not a machine gun shooter, you know, that sort of thing. And once finished, you can export in JPEG, TIFF, PSD, PNG, pretty much anything that you need. So that's the images taken care of. What about the graphics? Now, Adobe has Illustrator, obviously, and Affinity has Designer. Designer, like Illustrator, is a vector-based tool for designing logos, graphics, drawing artwork, that sort of thing. You can open any vector or graphics file, including illustrator.ai files, and then you are free to change anything. Designer works in images too, and I often use it to create exhibition stands. Let me show an example of one I created recently for a charity. First, I opened the printer's artwork file as a PDF, and then I created a new layer for the background image and another for the text. I imported the image and then overlaid the text on top. As you'd expect, the text is scalable, and you can then use other modes and different personas. There's the familiar outline view. This gives you the ability to do some funky things with the graphics and the text. Again, I don't want to get too involved in what this can do, as like Photo, I'd be here all day. So the other thing Affinity Suite has is an InDesign equivalent. They call it Publisher. And Publisher creates any type of layout from a single page flyer to a book or a magazine or a brochure or whatever. It has everything you'd expect of professional graphic design software, including master pages for page furniture, text and paragraph styles, and full layout design control. And here is a new project I'm working on. This is a fiction book I created, and I selected the page size, whether I need it as a single page or spreads. I created a couple of different master pages, added some logos, added page numbers which automatically count up. I can then pull in the text, images, graphics, and create the whole layout. So you can see it's got everything you need, and it allows you to swap between designer and photo personas in the same program, which means you can work on the images while you're working on the layout. Now, this is a simple use of the program, but it will hopefully show you what's possible. Now, the three programs that make up Affinity Suite are available for Mac, Windows, and iPad. Plus, there's a host of add-ons such as brush packs, overlays, textures, LUT packs, font packs, and so on. And these are available through the Affinity website. There's also a range of tutorials that will help with each program. So in my opinion, Affinity Suite is a credible alternative, but why swap from Adobe? The price. The full cost of Affinity Photo, Designer, and Publisher is £160, all bar a penny, which is about $180, $190, and that's it. There's no monthly subscription. And in case you were wondering, updates are free. And then when Affinity produces a new version, and it went from Affinity to Affinity version 2 a couple of years ago, you get a sweetened upgrade cost. And not only that, you can try the entire Affinity suite for free. And remember I said there was another reason to swap? Well, Adobe has been going all on AI of late. And let's just say Adobe's AI ambitions are a little bit muddy. It had to clarify what it meant by using customer data last year after a disastrous rewording of its terms of use. Personally, I'm not a fan of artistic generative AI. In fact, I'm not a great fan of generative AI full stop. In my view, AI was supposed to help me with my more mundane parts of my life, not the creative stuff. However, people have been raving about the AI features of Adobe's products, and Affinity has joined that game, not with generative AI, but with machine learning. Affinity Suite 2.6 now has the ability to download a pack that uses machine learning in elements such as subject selections and lots of other things. Personally, I've never found much issue with selections, but if you're doing a lot of cutouts, then it can be handy. So Affinity Suite is a perfect tool for creative workflows. You can buy each software on its own. Photographers can buy Affinity Photo, artists can buy Designer, but for the all-round creative, the suite is ideal. So if you run a creative studio, or you're a creative studio finance manager, or you're a small footprint creative team looking for an alternative to that monthly CS bill, Affinity could be your answer. It certainly is serious and credible competition to Adobe. And that's it. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.